you, ladies. Let's stand and let's celebrate that the King is in the room and that our Savior is here.
You are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all.
read Luke 19:37-38. As he was drawing near, already on the way down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." The Lord deserves our praises. He's worthy of our praises. God, we lift our praises to you. God, we honor you and we worship you. We turn our eyes to you, God. We remember all the good works that you've done in our lives, God. And we praise you. And we know that you're going to do more things, God. Because that's who you are.
Bless.
you, Lord. Streams of grace flow deep and wide. For all the love I've ever felt comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross.
Lord Jesus, this sort of strangest and most glorious reality of owing a debt we cannot pay and celebrating the one who paid it for us. Lord Jesus, it's a marvelous thing that you came. We celebrated Christmas, the incarnation, that God the Creator took upon yourself humanity and the most vulnerable of humanity, the infant come forth from the womb. But this is why you came, Lord. And today, as we begin to observe what we call Holy Week, Lord, today is when we see you placing your foot across the threshold to the destiny, the destination that had been determined from the very dawn of creation, Lord. And you made a promise. And you've come to fulfill it, Lord. And we are the beneficiaries and recipients of all the payoff of that promise. Lord Jesus, we cannot thank you enough. Lord, today, would you grace us by your Holy Spirit to see some of, more of your great heart, your spirit, your love, yes, for all of humanity, but for each of us as individuals as well. Lord, each of us receives this benefit of your sacrifice personally that empowers us to become your own children, Lord, members of your family with Christ Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Be glorified, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Yes. Yes. This is Palm Sunday, the start of what we call Holy Week, and Jesus begins his final approach to the culmination, really, of all of human history. Some of the benefit was still to play out, but this is the pivotal point for all of history and all of humanity, all of heaven, all of hell. So, knowing this, I'll just remind you, we will celebrate Friday night, Good Friday, the sacrifice of Jesus. We're going to have a joint service with Calvary here at 7 o'clock Friday night. Typically about a one-hour service. We will celebrate communion. We will hear from the Word of God Jesus' approach to the cross and the tomb, and just honor what he has done for this. When we do celebrate communion, he said, "Do this. When you do this, remember my death as often as you do until I come." And so that is what we will do. So today is what we call Palm Sunday, and think back on this day, and we'll take a look at an account, but think back on this day. Most of you know the story. And the word really that shot through everyone was Jesus is coming. And his fame had spread. There were few, if any, who had not heard of him. Many had not seen or heard him. Some probably doubted whether what they had heard was true or not. But when Jesus of Nazareth was mentioned, everyone knew this is the one that everyone is talking about, and many believed that he is Messiah. He's the promised one. He's the one who will bring the fullness of the rule and reign of God on earth. They had great hopes, a variety of hopes, big spectrum of hopes. So I'm going to invite you to try and put yourself, don't put yourself in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago, but put yourself in that mindset to the extent that you can. And if you're there, imagine yourself in that environment. What do you hope for from him? Here you are among these people, and you've heard the things that he's done. The miraculous, the raising of the dead, the healing of the blind, feeding of thousands from one person's small portion. What do you hope for from him? And something that you don't have yet. Paul makes it very clear, hope is about what we don't have yet. Nobody hopes for what they have already. And hope is confident expectation with pleasure for what we don't have yet. But we don't bemoan the lack of it. We look forward to it with hope and promise. Something that you have reason to expect. What do you hope for that you don't have yet, but you have reason to expect? And maybe you don't know how soon, but you do expect it. And maybe you've waited long enough that you've embraced this kind of extended pause where you don't have, you know, sometimes we have this sort of almost a requirement within our expectation that it will come soon. But time plays out and we're still waiting in faith. Maybe we feel like Joseph, who's finally landed in a dungeon in Egypt, falsely accused, thrown in prison, these incredible promises from God. Apparently no one believed him. And here he is, but yet the word says that until God brought it about, in a day that God's promise to him tested him. Maybe you're being tested with some of the things that you hope for. Something that you hope for before his return. Now, you know, I love that brief depiction of his return in 1 Thessalonians. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God. And part of what I hope for, and whether it's realistic or not, I think it's possible, is that I could still be here on earth breathing air on that day. And to hear that shout, and I told you some months ago, I think I finally discovered in the Word what he's going to shout. I wondered that for years. I thought, okay, the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout. What's he going to shout? I finally saw it in the Word several months ago, and I thought, yeah, that makes sense, Lord. Okay, now I get it. So imagine this scenario then with this hope or these hopes that you have, and it doesn't have to be just one thing. Could be many. Could be small. Could be large. Could seem almost a minor detail. Could be so grand that only God acting can pull this off. Only he can deliver. No one would think it was you or some other human being. Maybe it's for someone else. Maybe it's for yourself. Maybe it's for someone else. Maybe it's for loved ones. Maybe it's for people you've never even met before. But God has caused you to hope for them. So let's say figuratively, he gave you a blank check. Now don't think of it singularly as money, but even if it were. You know, and there's these ridiculous commercials on TV about what people would supposedly be able to do if they won the lottery, right? I'm not suggesting that what we hope for is winning the lottery, you know, but let's just say, and I've told you the story before about a guy, an extremely rich guy, giving Campbell McAlpine a blank check, a signed blank check, and what McAlpine did with it. But let's say he gave you a blank check. What would you use it for, given these hopes that you have, that Jesus is going to bring, he's going to provide before his return? Between now and his return, and these hopes that you to participate in, and if he gave you a blank check, would you spend it to bring that about? Would you spend it to make that a reality? And like I say, maybe it's not money, maybe it's some other resource, but how would you use it? So here's the day. I'm going to read the account of his coming from Matthew 21, and the first 17 verses. Now, when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord has need of them,' and immediately he will send them." All this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, "Who is this?" So the multitude, they had only seen the crowd. They weren't present, but they just rippled through the whole city. So the multitude said, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee." Then Jesus went into the temple of God and drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he said to them, "It is written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer,' but you have made it a den of thieves." Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant and said to him, "Do you hear what these are saying?" And Jesus said to them, "Yes. Have you never read? Out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise." Then he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, and he lodged there. I'm not going to unpack everything in there, but one of the things that hopefully you might be thinking about as we do go through some of what we'll consider this morning is that the healing of the blind and the lame happened after he cleansed the temple. So he was exactly who they thought he was. They had that part right. They were hoping he was Messiah, and he is. What did they want from him? Now, it probably spans the spectrum. But we see in verse 14 what some of them wanted from him, and they got it. The blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. They got what they were hoping for. I don't know that very many people anticipated or hoped for what he did before he healed them. And most of you that were here remember Charles preaching a sermon some months ago where he was preaching from an account of this, and he had a table up here, and he just shocked everyone. He just took that table and turned it over and flew it in our midst, and I'm pretty sure he had everybody's attention at that point. Jesus had their attention. What did they want from him? What do people who know who he is want from him today? And that might mostly be people who know him, but just say people who know who he is, because there were many people there who knew who he was but had not surrendered their lives to him yet. But what do people who know who he is want from him today? Many of us, myself included, want him to ride into town by his Spirit today. We pray for this. I was at a meeting Friday morning with a group of leaders that kind of span from Tacoma to Paulsbo, and asking together whether there are some things the Lord wants to do among our community, and really we're sort of concentrating this side of the bridge, you know, up to as far as Paulsbo, but what the Lord might do in August or September, and how he might have us cooperate together just to invite him and all of that. But what we want is we're praying that the Lord by his Spirit is going to come where we live, and he's going to be present and active and strong and demonstrative so that everybody is talking about who he is, you know, and not talking about a church or some personality or something like that, but who Jesus is. What do we want from him? What do you want from him? What do I want from him? I hope there's stuff rolling around in here. I hope you know that there are things that reside in your heart, sometimes make it through your mind and come out your mouth in the form of prayer, whether it's spoken audibly or it's just you and him. You know, I love praying out loud. And one of the things about praying in my car, you know, I've told you before, some people go for prayer walks. I go for prayer drives. But I can be as loud as I want. You know, I restrain myself in some prayer meetings because I know I scare some people if I just kind of turn it loose, you know. And I don't want to quiet them or hinder their prayers. But what do you want from him? What do we want from him together? Do we want awakening? Awakening really is amongst unbelievers. It's amongst people who they're not alive in who he is. Revival, and a lot of people mean that, and they use the word revival, but you can't revive what wasn't first vived, okay? And so revival is for believers who've kind of gone dormant or asleep. And do we want that? Do we want awakening amongst the community? Do we want revival amongst God's people? Who are the church? Do we want mass ingathering? I've heard many people giving what I know they intend is sort of prophetic utterances about this mass ingathering before Christ returns. I always say, okay, do I find evidence of that in his word? That's where I'm going to look when I hear things stated in his name. And there's a lot of well-intended, sort of good, honorable stuff. It's not malicious or selfish, but stated as if it were in concert with the Word of God. I just can't find anything to support it, you know? And so, okay, Lord, what have you said that we might base our hopes on? But do we want those things? I mean, those are good, righteous things that we could hope for and want. Awakening, revival, ingathering, resulting in what? Now, I realize, you know, this is not news to many of you. I'm a very practical person. You know, and I'm an A plus B, therefore C kind of person. I don't require that of God, but, you know, I'll remind you here, we've said it many times, we believe that the Word of God has intended practical application in our lives and empowers us to live with conviction of righteousness, with confidence that we're, you know, with God in his will and his ways, and we want that. So if we want these things, even great big things, resulting in what? Resulting in social or political reform? Because socially and politically, this country we live in, quite frankly, is a septic tank that needs to be pumped, you know? And I don't want to offend anybody, you know, and I'm a patriotic American to the core, but that never is going to intrude on or bring any definition to my faith in Christ. That's for sure. And anybody who doesn't look at the ill that is becoming pervasive and gathering speed and strength in our society, in our country, is either blind or not paying attention. Because the flood of sin is just, it's tsunami status, quite frankly. So what do we want? Do we want social and political reform? I know many people choose the candidates they're going to vote for, hoping that these candidates will be the occasion of some biblical righteousness being brought in as standards for what determines to be the governing guidelines of our country, our state, all of that. I wind up too often at the other end. I realize there's no one even available that I can honorably offer before God, and I'm not going to choose the least worst. The Bible says, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. And so if I can't vote for someone in faith, then I'll vote for no one, quite frankly, rather than just be pushed into some sort of corner that I would never allow myself to be put in. Is what we want today any different from what they wanted then? Really? Now, let me be honest with yourself. You don't even have to admit it out loud to anybody. I hope you would. I hope maybe in your close associations or in life group or in Bible studies or just good friends or family or something like that, we can talk freely about these things and not an environment where somebody's going to jump on you because they view it differently than you do or don't want the same thing you do. But is what is wanted amongst God's people, really, God's people, any different from what they wanted then? Do we want him to come and cleanse his temple? Do we want that? Because I know a lot of people who really want a lot of healing. That came after cleansing the temple. And so do we want him to come and cleanse his temple? Or do we want him to clean up government? Now, quite frankly, you know, and Ravel and I stopped partaking of the news 3.5 years ago. None of it was edifying. And so we chose to give our focus to things that could build us up instead. However, you know, I hear stuff, you know, and there's stuff that just floats by on your feed. Okay, you know, whatever. But I am in various measures distressed by people who solidly take the name of Jesus, and let's call them Christians, and then they advocate passionately for a political agenda or a candidate. And I've not yet found Jesus dabbling in politics in here yet. So I'm all for Christians being involved in politics. Don't get me wrong. Yes, go and be the influence that we can be. But the church is entirely different. Take the Christian and our biblical beliefs and convictions and take that into the political realm. But don't bring it into the church. The church is who Jesus is. And we're going to take a look at that here in just a minute. But do we want him to cleanse the temple, or do we want him to clean up government? Do we believe that his temple even needs cleaning? See. And what are we asking him for? Are you asking him for stuff? I hope you are. You know, a lot of my prayers are praise and worship and adoration, and there are things that I ask for that I believe he's promised that have to happen before he comes back, and I ask for those things. You know, I'm somewhat distressed when I know different solid Christian people. These people are just, wow, they love God, they love his word, but they have different beliefs about the occurrence of end time events, and they separate from each other over that. And I say that's a sad, sad thing, you know, because quite frankly, the Lord's going to do what he's going to do, whether you and I have it right or not. And since I know these whole groups of people that have it in different belief systems, some of them are not right. Right? I mean, that's pretty simple computation, right? But is Christ more powerful than that stuff? He better be more powerful than social mores and politics. What do we want? What does he want? Does he want to rule over Congress more than he wanted to rule over Rome? Because I hear a lot of Christians appear to be really passionate about his authority being exerted in state legislatures and in Congress and city councils and county councils and things like that. So does he want to rule over civil government more now than he did over Rome? Because even John the Baptist, who was no shrinking violet, this guy was nobody's doormat. He was an in-your-face kind of guy. And Roman soldiers who were being drawn to Jesus came to him and said, what do we do? He said, be honest soldiers. Don't lie, don't cheat, don't steal. He didn't say, leave the dirty, rotten Roman army, quit serving Caesar. He didn't say that. He said, honor the Lord in what you do wherever you're at. What do Christians want this election year? And I'm concerned about that. And that's literally what drove us from the news 3.5 years ago, the last election year, major election year. And the contention is just, there's nothing about Christ in it. And so I'm thinking, Lord, how are your people going to evidence ourselves in your behalf? Because if we are his, if we call ourselves Christians, if we're willing to be known as Christians, then he gets tagged with what we do and say by people who don't know him yet. See? And convictions as individual citizens is one thing, but as church is another. What do we want? Do we want Christ to rule our country, or do we want him to rule his church? Which is more important? Which does he want to be more influential, the government or the church? Which do we think can and should be? What did he tell us to pray? Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You know, I'm an optimist, and I'm not really here to ferret out error. You know, if there's sin among us that have relationships, then yeah, I want to deal with it. But when you walk through the doors of a church and the whole entryway is festooned with political stuff, gives me pause, I'll tell you that. Where does he want to be more influential? In society, people's lives at large, whole. Government or the church? When the Lord has changed society in the past, post-Reformation, after the Reformation, he used the church, not government, to change all of society. And he didn't send the church to government. He sent them into the everyday life of society, and that found its way, it leached into representative government that changed. Luther brought about some change, didn't he? Wesley, are you kidding me? Now, England still, in effect, ruled the world economically and militarily. And he changed England by preaching to coal miners. They preached to others also, but they started at the bottom and worked their way from there. They didn't shoot for the top. They let it work up from there. There's a couple of great stories about Wesley. I'll just share the one. And he'd become very well known and was invited to a dinner at the prime minister's home. And so this is very important people. And I don't know exactly, it's been a long time since I read it, how the courses of the meal went, but whether it was before dessert or after, I don't know, but there was going to be some entertainment, probably a string quartet or something, and then maybe the dessert. And Wesley excused himself. He said, I have to go. And the prime minister said, well, why would you go now? We haven't even had our entertainment. He said, well, I have an appointment at 4:30 in the morning. And the prime minister said, who makes appointments at 4:30 in the morning? He said, I have an appointment every morning at 4:30. Enough said. Whitfield? George Whitfield? Wow. Wilberforce? Now, Wilberforce is most known for a political fight he fought in Christ's name for 34 years that eventually abolished the slave trade in the British Empire. But they had a second agenda that wasn't outwardly as well known, but was every bit as successful. And it's what they called the Reformation of Society. We might call it the Restoration of Humanity. They call it the Reformation of Manners. That's what they called it. We might call it the Restoration of Morality. And they gave themselves to becoming influenced with biblical morality through the smallest groups and lowest level society till after about 20 years, morality became so popular because the influence went up to people who had influence. Morality became so popular that hypocrites were pretending to be biblically moral. Now, the net result for society is good. This becomes the standard that the society is conducting itself by. See, it was an incredible thing. And they were called the Clapham Group. But think about William Booth, once again in England. And he was ordained in the Church of England, and he was coming home one night, and there was some tavern districts. They congregated them together. And I mean, these were as vile neighborhoods as you could find, but he took a shortcut through there, and he saw all of this debauchery and heard everything going on, and he was drawn to this one tavern, and he went and he stood outside and he began to sing, and it drew people, and they came out, and once they came out, he began preaching the gospel of Jesus to them, and they threw beer at him, they threw food at him, they threw their mugs at him, they pelted him with every vile thing they could find, and he went home and told his wife, I found my destiny. They changed England and influenced the world. Their foundation was prayer. Think about Charles Finney. Billy Graham says Charles Finney is the greatest preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ in the history of the United States. Graham would say that in the wake of their crusades, you go out 10, 15 years, somewhere between 8 and 10% of the people who came forward had remained true to their faith that many years out. But his best research said that more than 80% of those who responded to Christ under Finney's preaching remained true to Christ their whole lives. Finney would, and a guy that wasn't Catholic, but he called him Father Nash, and it was sort of his prayer right-hand man, and God would assign a city or a county, and they would pray until the Lord gave them the green light. You know, then they go in. That's what Graham did also when the thing first jumped off in 1949 in Los Angeles. They prayed for 18 months. But they would pray, and then the Lord would turn them loose, and the Holy Spirit would become so present in a town that there were some stories of committed, godless men, businessmen who had reviled faith and the church and everything else, riding into town, and nobody speaking to them, falling off their horse in the street, begging God for mercy and repenting of their sin just by the presence of the Holy Spirit in that town. Wow, how'd you like to live in that town? That'd be pretty cool, wouldn't it? You know, do we pray for that? Are we asking for anything like that when we say, Lord, come where we live, come amongst us, be the most prevalent influence in and through your people? That's how he starts. But so that our society is saturated with who you are. Think about D.L. Moody, this ruffian. He was a tough guy. He was a troublemaker. And he got saved out of the tough neighborhoods. And you know where Sunday school came about? Well, Moody, he'd go to these churches, you know, and he just didn't fit in. And so he hung around and he was sort of cleaning up his act a little bit. And finally he went to some church leaders and says, well, when are you going to start, you know, doing the healing and praying and stuff like that? And he said, oh, we don't do that anymore. And he thought, well, that's a shame, you know. And so he began asking if he could teach Sunday school, and they weren't going to let this guy at their Sunday school people. And so they told him, tell you what, you round up your own students and you can teach all the Sunday school you want. End result was a 4-floor warehouse filled with about 2,000 street kids. It was Sunday school classes hearing the gospel every day. That's where Sunday school came from. And this troublemaker just went to other troublemakers, and he wound up impacting the whole world. But it came through the church. Do you understand that? It wasn't because they voted for the right people or the right party or the right legislation. I'm not saying that stuff is insignificant. I'm just saying it's not God's primary influence he intends in society. Weren't the Romans still in charge when we read the book of Acts? And these people changed the world. And none of them ever got elected to anything. Does the church look like he rules it according to his standards? And if not, why not? Because that's up to us. And if we're going to start thinking about what we're going to ask him for, what we want because he's come, I think first we ask him to come. And then how do we make sure he's in charge? Well, we make sure that we're not. Okay? As some of you know, I was a very forceful, self-directed individual before I got saved and involved in small businesses and stuff like that, and things were going to go my way, you know. And one of the first things I heard the Lord say to me when I got saved was, you're not in charge anymore. Okay, you know, as long as we're clear on that, I'm good with that, you know. Yeah, are we not in charge? Are we willing to be not in charge? Are we willing to step aside and place him in charge over his church? Now, I love calling it my church and our church. That means like my family. We belong, right? But we don't own it. He does. See? And we make ourselves bond slaves. We voluntarily make ourselves indentured servants to Jesus. Yeah, cool. Or is the church trying to influence government rather than becoming more like Christ who changes the world? I really want you to consider this, especially headed into this election year. What does Jesus want? What does he encourage? I'm not saying that stuff's not important. I'm just saying it's so far behind what's number one that they're not even found on the same spreadsheet, okay? Is the church supposed to be different because of government? I hope not. You know? My goodness, part of what happened, you know, I mean, in Nazi Germany, you know, in the 30s, Bonhoeffer was one of a very few who stood up. And then they had to go into hiding because the Nazis were going to hunt him down. And he was in the U.S. teaching, and they said, look, we got a place for you here. Don't go home. They're going to kill you, you know. Just stay here till this is over, and, you know, then you can go back and do really great things. And he said, I can't do that. I belong where God has planted me with my people. Of course, he got arrested, and the orders were, when the Allied forces were closing in, I mean within 30 miles, make sure that guy dies before you leave. But Bonhoeffer said, if I do not demonstrate the love of Christ to my Nazi prison guards, I have no right to take his name in my mouth. And that was the most important thing to him. Jesus is not coming back for government. Now, he's coming back, but he's coming back for the church. You know that, right? He's coming back for the bride of Christ. That's who he's coming back for. Not only is he not coming back for government, he's bringing it with him. And the government will be on his shoulders, and those who are his will rule and reign with him. And nobody's going to have to be elected. Jesus is going to say, okay, I want you to serve here. I mean, you know, we've become so anti-government because they're liars and cheats and thieves and thugs and bullies and out for themselves and all of that. That won't be that way. And people will be serving in his name, in his authority, with nothing but love governing every human interaction. Wow. But I get distressed. I've known friends that I think got up. Now, I was, you know, off course myself. During the 90s, beginning in 1989, and for probably 12 years. And God was patient, and we did some good. You know, I had uncommon influence in the legislature, saw some great election victories in various legislation and things like that. But I think it was 2001, maybe 2002, the Lord said, you're done. That's over. Okay. And I came to believe that because I can't, especially in public things, I can't not be identified as Pastor Kurt Mack of Peninsula Christian Fellowship in Gig Harbor. To the public, that's who I am. And so I can't do something that's not attached to who Jesus is, because I'm living in behalf of the church. And the Lord said, I don't want you putting Jesus behind these political agendas, you know. So, but he's bringing government with him. The church's job, is this the one I want? No, I'll get to that one. Did I miss one? No. The church's job, I printed it out, is identified, the church's job is to be Jesus. Do we realize that? 1 John 4:17. Love has been perfected among us. So this is not just for an individual to love. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. Now, we is plural. It's not a collection of individuals. It's a And so here's Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 11 through 16, writing about this very thing. For no foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, or precious stones, I'll come back to that. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear. For the day, capital D, that's that 1 Thessalonians thing when the Lord himself descends from him with a shout, will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. Do you not know that you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? All three instances of that word you are plural. They're not singular. Does he dwell in us individually? I sure hope so. But if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, and Peter wrote, coming to him as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious, you also as living stones are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Christ Jesus. Living stones fit together into a building. It is the house of God, the temple of God, which is the church. And I told you years ago, my goodness, probably more than 20, at least 20 years ago, maybe more, Ravel and I were spending a weekend down south of Cannon Beach at Arch Cape, and it's a Sunday morning, and I had served a prayer summit that week, and we flipped on the TV, and there was an NFL game on, and I just, something in me just said, nah, don't watch the game. So I start flipping through the channel, and I land on this National Geographic program about some of these stone buildings up in the Andes in South America that have been standing there for 700 years. The better part of these buildings. They're stone buildings. And then they start getting into that. Why are they still standing? Because there is no mortar. There are no pins or dowels. And all of these stones, no matter the size, were on all four sides, were shaped either concave or convex. And the short version is they just kept chiseling away until they got them so tightly fit together that they couldn't get a chisel or a fight in anymore. And they held each other together. It was their spatial relationship and the weight of them to each other that held these things together. And they withstood earthquakes and storms and wars and all kinds of this stuff. And it was stones fit together in a building. And that's who Peter's describing. That's who we are. See, and do we let God shape us and smooth us? Part of the problem is, you know, a word says like iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens the countenance of their friend. Well, it can be irritating, you know. I mean, your friend's grating on you. Yeah, sometimes it needs to happen. They're the ones that are best qualified to rub the sharp edges off of us, make us a little smoother, you know what I mean? Yeah, and especially with each other. We don't back away because of that. That's a good thing, you know. That's who Peter says, this, what Paul describes. Peter says what that is. Back in the 80s, 1980s, not that old, there was a doctor up in Canada named John White, a very vibrant Christian man who the Lord had given voice into much of the church. And he said, we'll recognize revival when we hear God playing his church like a concert pianist playing a grand piano. Doesn't that sound good? Doesn't that sound good? And Natalie, I love your playing, and the keyboard's fine, but when you move to the piano, well, the sound just gets bigger, you know, fuller, you know. I've loved that quote. For 40 years, I've loved that quote. Wow. Let's let the world hear the music again. You know, maybe cleansing his temple is like tuning the piano. The guy we've been using for years, you know, sort of moved on. You know, we're quite a bit older. We brought in a guy this year to tune the piano. This guy took the thing apart. Analyzed all the parts before he put it back together so that when he tuned it, everything would be in right relationship as best as is possible with that particular instrument. And he said, here's some things you're probably going to need to replace, you know, down the road a little ways, you know. We want Jesus to do that with us because there is no cruise control. And we've talked before, we've never arrived. There's milestones. There's no destinations. This side of heaven, we're moving in that direction. Yeah. Come, Lord Jesus. They were jacked that day. They were pumped. Wow. Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth, he's coming into the city. And we think he's the Messiah. And he's going to do stuff that God promised. Nobody else can do. Now, the problem was they thought he was going to depose Caesar. He wasn't. He wanted to depose them. Right? And they wouldn't put up with it. So moved out to the Gentile world. And Paul, this Jew of Jews, this Hebrew of Hebrews, this Pharisee, the guy with all the PhDs, said, I'm done. I'm out here. God sent me to the Gentiles. Thank you, Lord. And you and I have been adopted into the family of God. Paul even talks about being grafted in to the original plant. You know, wow, that's who we get to be. He says, we are the true Jews who've had our hearts circumcised, not our bodies, you know, not cutting the flesh away. Come, Lord Jesus, be our greatest desire. Lord, that's part of the stuff I ask for, Lord, that you, personally, you, would be the greatest desire of our hearts, your church. Rule our lives and your church, please, Lord. We're asking you to rule. We know you're loving, and Lord, here's this passionate prayer. I couldn't count the times that I've recited and read it here amongst us these many years. John 17, 20 to 23, the most passionate thing you pray before they arrest you and murder you. You say repeatedly four times that we all would be one as you and the Father are one. You and us in you, us in them, you two in us. Wow, by your Holy Spirit, oh my goodness, Lord, do that, please. Or would you so convict us of righteousness that it's compelling? Being conviction of sin isn't even an issue. That stuff's just falling away as we move toward you in righteousness. We understand it can't stay. And Lord, would you influence our world through your body? The church? The body of Christ? Wow. Lord, I'm sitting here looking at Palm Sunday, and you walking into the city, and you say, okay, we're going to start this thing. We're going to do it. Lord, Friday night, we're going to look at the price you paid. And then, of course, thank you, Lord, we already know Sunday. We're going to celebrate the reward that you reaped with that price that you paid. And it was our lives, our forgiveness, our salvation. Wow, Lord. And then you tell us to go out and be like you. Do for others what you did for us. Not in the sacrificing, but in the teaching and the learning and the following and all of that disciple making. Wendy, why don't you guys come on back up? So, as we often do, I'm going to offer some things to pray and do for us. And whether you jot them down, you can go to the website, you know, everything's there. The notes are on the website. You can print them or write them out or whatever. Ask him to make his body, the church, your greatest public priority. I mean it. So far above politics and candidates that they can't even be measured. No one and nothing are deserving of coming alongside the Lord Jesus Christ. And as the church, we not only don't have any greater priority, we don't have any other priority. We're not sent to anything that we couldn't be found in him and with him in his behalf. We go touch that stuff, but only in and with him. Second, ask him to reveal what needs cleansing in his church. And that doesn't mean that, you know, we're drinking and smoking and carousing and stealing and fighting and all of that. Doesn't mean all of that, you know. Go back and read 1 Corinthians 3, 11 through 16 and just say, Lord, what do you want to clean up amongst us? And Lord, start with me. And so how can I represent you by bringing a greater degree of what's clean in you amongst my brothers and sisters? And when he reveals something, don't discard it. Don't just discard it. Replace it. Replace it. Romans 12:2 says to Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then it says in 12:21, overcome evil with good. And the language talks about displacing, and it's like pouring in the good till it flushes out the bad. And that's how we go. We don't attack what's bad. We increase what's good, see? And that's how he wants us to do that. Ask him to give you greater influence in the whole church. Not just this congregation, but ask him how he might have you in his behalf become a greater influence in the whole church beyond your own congregation. Ask him to give you greater passion for Christ. He gave his passion for us, what we call this Passion Week. Ask him to give you greater passion for him. Ask him for what he approves in earthly affairs. Okay, here's the elections and the politics and all of that. Just use your influence, cast your vote, knowing you enjoy his approval, his affirmation. If you don't, then don't. Okay? And align yourself accordingly. And some of that, for some of us, is going to be like Peter on Simon the Tanner's roof. And we're going to be praying, and the Lord's going to show up, and he's going to say something like, you know, this here that you are so passionate about and you so strongly advocate, you're not getting that from me. I want you to let go of that and replace it with something from me instead. Lord Jesus, thank you for coming. I wonder, you know, what you were thinking as this joyous tumult was going on, and you knew what they wanted, and you knew what you came to do, and you knew how well you would not be received ultimately, and you did it anyway. And we want to be looking unto Jesus, the author and completer, perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him, the joy that was out in front, you could rightfully say that he hoped for, that he had confident expectation with pleasure that wasn't there yet, the joy before him, which was our salvation, endured the cross, despising the shame. It's okay to despise, you didn't have to like that. Of course not. Sat down at the right hand of the Father. And he wants to come by his Holy Spirit among us now. I think he wants to do an awful lot in building up his temple, his church, before he returns from heaven with a shout. And he wants us to embrace and really love our response to him, even when it means discarding, replacing some things that we've felt very strongly about up to this point. Peter said, Lord, not me. Lord, I know what I'm about. I don't do that. And he said, well, I'm changing things for you. Let us be willing to say that. Please stand. We're going to sing before we go out into this beautiful day.
Because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Because when we see you, because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Oh, that. Fear is washed away when we are sitting in perfect love. So God, I praise you that in your presence we find perfect love. And I ask that we would seek your presence daily, God. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, be blessed. Happy Palm Sunday. We'll see you next week at Easter and Good Friday. Yep, Friday night.